Ladies and gentlemen, we apologize. We are coming from different meetings. So we're going to get started here with our presentation. Most of you have already seen the presentation again, but we are here tonight just to, again, go over it for the board to continue to look at. There are a couple cards. If you didn't get one, if you have any questions, please write the card. Write the question on the card, hand to the end. And I will come around and I'll pick them up myself personally. Ladies and gentlemen, we do not have a lot of time this evening, so I will take the card at the end of the presentation. We'll try to answer as many of the questions as possible. But as you know, most of you have already asked quite a few questions to the board, the superintendent, Mr. Zachary, Mr. Harold Bryson have seen the questions. So without further ado, I'm not going to make an appointment, Mr. Zachary, and we will be done. We'll be done by 8 o'clock because we have these. You can hear me. We'll be done by 8 for today. Tomorrow we'll come back at 7:30 to 9, the same location too. All right?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ladies and gentlemen, what we have up on the board is, for the screen, is a Google map that is populated with data with our students here in Stratford. Mr. Bryce has partnered with me to try to come up with this map. So we're going to go through a couple maps very quickly. This one is race, and it's done with how the state defines race. The state does it in two groups, minority or non-minority. So a bunch of racial and ethnic groups are lumped together in the minority category, and the non-minority category is typically defined as Caucasian. This projector is not very good color-wise, but this is yellow. And this is blue. Is that correct, Harold? I apologize, projector, but it's not giving colors properly. So what you're looking at right now is the north end of town. There's Roosevelt Forest. There's Merritt Parkway. What this map is basically showing, we'll scroll down, is showing where every elementary age student in Stratford who attends Stratford Public Schools resides. So for instance, here we have a student or a family, it could be more than one student, Caucasian family living there, and slightly down is a minority family. Could be Hispanic, could be African American, could be Asian, could be Native American. We don't get into that detail. We'll do that a little later. Harold, can you scroll down the map for me, please? So, as you go down, you see a lot of yellows, a lot of bluish slash purples. So there's Worcester Park, so you get a landmark, Bulldog Boulevard, it means where Bunnell High School is. Harold, go down a little further. Once again, yellows and blues. You see a concentration of blues here. A little further, Harold, please. Concentration of blues around Franklin, and a concentration of blues in the Stratford Academy area, but you also see some yellows there. Harold, can you get down the lordship, please? See a lot fewer kids, a lot more yellows. So that's basically what the state, how the state views us, what it looks like. Harold, can you go to the school color one, please? Thank you, sir. So, now we get a little interesting. This is where these kids are based on where they attend school. We've got a multitude of colors because we have a multitude of schools. This is actually blue, it's chapel. Okay? Harold, which was red again? Red is Whitney. I believe this is yellow for Second Hill. Green is Wilcoxon. This is purple for Nichols. I forget what color was for Franklin.
You can't actually see it. It's a really small dot.
Okay. Well, he says you can't see Franklin because you have to use a small dot because they ran out of big logos like that. So as you zoom in, you see all these multicolored locations. So if we take this area right here, this is basically the Franklin area. But you notice the little small dot is Franklin, but you see the colors for other schools. They're all over the district. Harold, can you go down to Stratford Academy area, please? So if you get in the Stratford Academy area, this is the sort of the problem we're talking about. You've got a multitude of colors. Remember, the blues are chapel, so all these blues are going all the way to the north end of town. You've got purples here, you have yellows, you have greens, you have small dots. Harold, come down to lordship, please. Lordship is down here. So, Harold, can you go back to Stratford County and drill down to like the street level, please? So as we get to an actual street level, McKinley Ave right here, student Green, what did we say Green was, Harold? Wilcoxon. So we got on one McKinley Ave, this one block of McKinley Ave, we have one kid going to Wilcoxon, one going to Purple, which I believe was Nichols, got a Blue Chapel, I can't tell if that's red or... So that's one street. We've got four different schools represented on one street. So if you look at it a little further out, you also see the rainbow of colors. So what we, as Dr. Robinson's pointed out, when we started the racial balancing plan in the early 90s, this was absolutely necessary because of the sort of lack of diversity in the town. What we're seeing now is we tend to have a pretty, a more diverse situation than we had in the 1990s. Harold, can you go to the next one, please? So this is all Caucasian students in the district. Harold, zoom in a little bit, please. You'll see from the Roosevelt Forest or from Shore to Forest, you've got Caucasian students in every area. Harold, can you do the African American, please? Zoom in, please. Once again, you have African Americans up and above the Merritt, Chapel Hill, Whitney, Wilcoxon. You have a concentration here around Franklin, another concentration, Stratford Academy, and some down here in Lordship. Hispanic, please. Zoom in, please. Same thing. You've got Hispanics north of the Merritt, Chapel, Wilcoxon, Whitney, Second Hill, Nichols, another concentration here in Stratford Academy area, and even down here in Lordship. The last one, Harold, please. So remember the first one we showed how the state uses everybody in one group? If we break them out, we get our little rainbow kaleidoscope of colors. So north of the Merritt, you've got yellows, Caucasians, you have blues, African American, you have red, Hispanics. Same thing in this area. Same thing in this area. You get concentrations of quote unquote minorities here and here. The problem we have is this concentration, we have to pay the bus somewhere. And what we're talking about is how do we service these children without having to bus them? Because by our records, we're busing approximately 790 kids in this area to other schools. That's a lot of buses and a lot of kids you're transporting. Harold, can you go down to Lordship? Once again, not a densely populated area. That's why you see fewer kids, heavily populated area. So one of the things that someone has asked me is like, you know, the town hasn't changed and we're the same as it was back in the 1990s. So I want to show you all something. Today is the 7th of May. On May 3rd, there was an article in the Washington Post called America's More Diverse than Ever, but Still Segregated. It talks about, I'm sorry, May 2nd, not May 3rd. So May 2nd, 2018. We'll post this link to our website so you all can view it yourself. But what's interesting about this story, they talk about Washington, D.C., Houston, and Chicago, but what's really interesting is you can scroll down and you can check your own local area. So we're going to scroll down. So here, it says, how integrated is your city? That's the headline at the bottom of the page here. So I'm going to put in Stratford's zip code and we're going to see. So here's the interesting thing. It's going to give us data from 1990, back when we approximately started our racial balance program. Give us data from 18 years ago. Give us data from 8 years ago, and then give us data from last year. All right? So we can notice we're going to do race first, and then we're going to do diversity. These are the color codes. Black is blue. Asian appears to be green. Native American appears to be orange. White appears to be red, Hispanic is yellow, and other appears to be some form of purple. let's type in 066. Can't see in the dark. All right, Stratford, Connecticut, 0615. All right, so let's go to 1990 and see what we see. So this is Stratford, Connecticut, Breeder area. So let's zoom in. Remember we said red was Caucasian, blues were African American, yellows were Hispanics. So Lordship, you see a lot of reds. Stratford County, you see some blues and yellow, a few reds. You see more around Barnab. So let's keep going up. You see all the reds in the Wilcoxon, Whitney area. So that, once again, this is 1990. Keep going further up. More reds, more reds. So let's see what happens. We change the year 2000. Start to see more colors besides red. It's starting to spread out a little bit. Let's go to 2010. All this data is from the US Census, by the way, so it's from federal government records. Once again, the colors are spreading out. But the real interesting thing, instead of seeing the dots, is we change it to diversity. I'm put it back in 1990. So in diversity, here's the scale. Purple means less diverse, green means more diverse, all right? So closer to purple, less diverse, closer to green, more diverse. So in 1990, you see a whole lot of purple. Lordship purple, Stratford Academy green, purple, purple. Scroll up, more purple. Keep going up, more purple. So that's 1990. That was the problem that our busing solution was designed to fix. Based on this map, we clearly had a diversification problem in the 1990s. So remember those colors. Let's go to 2000. See what we have. Some more greens have shown up. The purples are not as rich. They're getting more, a little more towards red. It's changing. Go to 2010, changing even more. That green is spreading. The purples are getting lighter as we move further up. Still up north, we've still got a little more purple. So let's fast forward to 2 years ago, 2016. Go all the way down, Lordship. The only truly purple area in Lordship now is literally right on the water. You got a lighter shade of purple, even lighter shade, greens. We move further up. All greens, lighter purple, a little dark purple there. Even lighter. So it's the message that the data that Harold provided his map is confirmed by the U.S. Census data, and that you've got all these with raw dark purples are now light grays or green, light greens or even dark greens. So this is sort of the thing that we're seeing in the school district, and that we've been trying to convey to folks that the town has changed in the last 28 years. And right now we have a solution that was designed for the 1990s, which is rather expensive, that may not be appropriate for whatever our current situation is. So, like I said, we'll put this URL on our website. This is from the Washington Post on May 2nd. But here's the thing. let's talk numbers here. So those who all were at the meeting of the night, you've seen this, but I'm going to talk to it a little bit. All right. This is probably too hard for you all to see. I'll try to blow it up. But what we've done is we've looked at all our kids. So we'll take chapel, for instance. These are all the kids that are based at chapel. But where they're at. So that says Wilcox and Stratford Academy, Victoria Soto, Johnson House, Second Hill, Nichols, Lordship, Franklin, Eli Whitney, Chapel. So according to this, we have 309 students that should be chapel based. Of that 309, 228 are actually at chapel. You've got 27 at Johnson, 13 at Soto, 3 at Wilcoxon, 3 at Second Hill, 13 at Second Hill, 3 at Nichols, 2 at Lordship, 5 at Franklin, 15 at Eli Whitney. Well, this also says if every kid that was at chapel was at chapel, its minority population would be 47%. 145 out of 309, for the mathematicians in the room, you do the calculation, it'll come out to be 47%. Same thing at Franklin, did the same thing. There's 375 kids that are based at Franklin, only 180 of them are in the building. If all the, every minority student was back at Franklin, also, it would be 83%. So we did this for each school. So this is Lordship and Nichols. There's only 125 kids that are Lordship based. Now Lordship has almost 300 kids in it, so, and out of the 125, only 85 of them are actually from Lordship, that are in Lordship. They have 12 at Soto, 19 at Johnson, 7 at Second Hill, 1 at Nichols, 1 at Franklin. Now Nichols is sort of the opposite of Lordship. Lordship's not enough kids to fill the building with Lordship-based kids. There are more kids that are Nichols-based than we can accommodate the building. Nichols has 572 kids that are Nichols-based, only 344 of them in the building. Lordship's minority population, if everyone was there, would be 18%. Nichols would be 63%. By the way, our district average for elementary is 59%, so our legal mandate is to be within 25 percentage points north and south of 59%. Eli Whitney and Wilcoxon. There's 454 students that are based in Eli Whitney, only 364 are actually in the building. They've got 2 at Wilcoxon, 24 at Victoria Soto, 37 at Johnson, 33 at Second Hill, 2 at Nichols, 1 at Lordship, 4 at Franklin, 13 at Chapel. Minority population, if everyone was there, it'd be 37%. Wilcoxon. Total population, 358 students. Minority population, 124, 35%. Most of the students are at Wilcoxon, but you'll see 17 at Soto, 38 at Johnson, 30 at Second Hill, 10 at Nichols, 1 at Franklin, 10 at Whitney, and 6 at Chapel. For every one of those kids, not everyone, the majority of those kids are not in their base school, it means we're busing them somewhere. Their parents may drive them, but we have an obligation to provide a bus for them. Unless they're on a boundary line waiver, in that case, the district is not responsible for busing them. Second Hill Lane. When Dr. Roberts and I arrived at Second Hill Lane, there were 700 kids in the building. There's only 368 that are based at Second Hill Lane. The building has capacity of 700 plus. Of that 368, 290 are actually in the building. You've got 2 at Wilcoxon, 21 at Soto, 35 at Johnson, 3 at Nichols, 9 at Franklin, 3 at Eli Whitney, 7 at Chapel. Its minority population, if everyone was in the building, would be 48%. Stratford Academy. All total, now some of you saw I had a number of 1,074. That number gets reduced because I took out the outplacement and the magnet school kids that are in all these schools. So 822 in our district for Stratford Academy base. 118 are at Soto, 159 are at Johnson. That means that all the rest is somewhere else. There's 82 kids at Wilcoxon, 138 at Second Hill Lane, 37 at Nichols, 181 at Lordship, 87 at Franklin, 87 at Eli Whitney, 153 at Chapel. That's a lot of kids we're busing. So the minority population would be 79%. So the question is, can we restructure this in some way where we're not paying for the buses? So if those of you were at the meeting of the night, you also be familiar with this, where we talked about busing. So this is our current busing situation. We have three tiers in Stratford. Tier one is our high school buses, our parochial school, our BOAG and technical schools. Bunnell High School has 16 buses, 6 vans. Stratford High has 6 buses, 3 vans. We send a bus for, one bus for Alfred Strive down at Birdseye. We have a bus that leaves Bunnell and goes to Aquaculture School in Bridgeport. One bus leaving Stratford High going to Aquaculture School in Bridgeport. One bus going to Bulla Havens. 4 buses going to Platte Tech. We have 3 buses for St. James, 2 buses for St. Mark's. A total of 35 buses in our first tier. Our rate for next year, July 1 is our fiscal new fiscal year, is $313.94 per bus. So let's round it $314. So that means for those 35 buses, daily cost is just shy of $11,000 a day. We have 182 days in a year. 182 times that number comes up to be just shy of $2 million. That's just buses. Vans, on the hand, are $290 a day rounding. We have 19 of those, so works out to be $5,500 per day times 182 days. Is another $1 million. This does not include our busing for special ed, which is another $1 million. So we've annually spent in excess of $4 million on busing. So what we're talking about is, when we talk about all those kids from Stratford Academy that are going to Chapel and Second Hill Lane, 11 buses to Chapel, 8 buses to Second Hill Lane. Now the kids going into Victoria Soda and Johnson, 9 buses. So the question is, can we get rid of that number, and that number, and maybe reduce some other ones? Problem is, before we get here, we gotta reduce them here. Before we can reduce them here, we gotta reduce them there. So the first issue is, can we reduce the 35 buses and 19 vans on tier one? We think we have some strategies to do that, but before we get down here, it has to be addressed up there, because we pay for a bus for the entire day. So if we need it up here, we have it for the rest of the day. So the question is, can we eliminate some buses out of this 35 and out of this 19 to get that number down, and then get this number down? That is the dilemma we're trying to address. Because at the end of the day, the two high schools cost us approximately $2 million each to operate. Busing, we spend $4 million. So basically, we spend on busing, we spend for two different high schools, which we don't have. So the question is, not just saving the money for our shortfall now, can we save additional money to reinvest that in actually educating kids instead of moving kids? I'd much rather hire more teachers and develop new programs than send a check to Durham Bus Company. They're nice partners and all, but I don't really like the idea of sending them $4 million every year. So this is what we're trying to get down. That number there, which will trickle down to here, which will trickle down to here. So if we can get that number down so we can save the money we're hoping to save, that's the one we're facing. In order to do that, children need to be in a school where they don't need to be bused. That is the dilemma. But our problem is, we've got more kids in this neighborhood, and based on our old plan, we have to bus them elsewhere. So the question now, with the increased diversification of our town, do we need to continue busing them? We're of the opinion of the central office that you're not going to eliminate busing, but you can decrease it. So the question is for the board is, do they take these steps to decrease the busing to try to free up some of that capital to meet our shortfall and maybe reinvest in the district? That's sort of the short and sweet of it. I know the chairman asked me to leave some time for questions, so I'll wrap it up there. At the end of the day, we have, at this point, less than 60 days to figure this out, because our fiscal year begins July 1, and we need to have an answer in place, ready to go by that date. We don't have to have it fully operational until the school starts, but decisions have to be made in a timely fashion. So that's what we're trying to deal with at this point. It's a, Dr. Robinson's used the term, we have a technical problem and an adaptive problem. The money, the bus is a technical solution to an adaptive problem. We're gonna try to balance that out one way, the hopefully minimal impact, but at the end of the day, we've gotta find some way to close a $2.2 million fiscal shortfall. Mr. Chairman? Dr. Robinson, you wanna?
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Delegano's having the custodial staff. There we go. Bring the house lights up. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, here we go. In no particular order, I just put something the way they gave it to me. Please do not be offended in any way. There's no selection process except for we will answer the ones that are specifically germane to the topic that we're talking about.
First question, ready?
Yes, sir.
Okay, question. Can you explain how exactly you would cut the equivalent of 12 to 13 buses?
Sure. I just lost my signal. Harold, did you close it?
Sitting here. So the last
So, the question was, how do we eliminate 12 to 13 buses? So, first order of business, we got to start tier one. So, we literally go bus by bus and check ridership for each bus. For instance, at Bunnell, there are 16 buses. 15 of them are pretty full. Can't do anything about it. But one has 16 kids on it. So, the question is, do I need a bus with 16 kids? So, I hope to take one off Bunnell. Stratford High, I don't recall how many we have there, but that's one there. Auckland and VH to Auckland, Stratford High, Auckland. Right now, we require our students to go to their home school, sign in, then get on another bus and go to Auckland. I'm going to recommend we just send them straight to Auckland on one bus instead of going to go to their individual schools. So now I picked up another bus, that's two. Bullet Havens, got 13 kids, can't do anything about that. See if I can consolidate some Platt Tech. I've got 37, 23, 21, and 29. Probably can't do anything there. I know I've got five buses here between St. James and St. Mark's. I've had a discussion with one of the principals about having to change their start time. What I would do is take these five, this entire group, move them down to tier two. That frees up space on tier one. You say, well, what happens to tier two? But guess what? If we don't need bus staff, that means I can move Nichols and Wilcox down to tier three, and all the elementary will be on the same schedule. So I've got five there, plus one, two, seven. So until I get the details of here, now I may not get them all on buses. That's where vans also come into play. The vans gets very particular because the van students generally may have special ed needs. So I've got to go through each individual kid and see what their needs are and can we consolidate some of these vans. Maybe we can, maybe we can't. That literally involves us going kid by kid, reading their 504s and saying, what does this child need to get to school? So one, let's assume we get one out of Stratford High. That's two, that's three. So that's eight right there. About just off back of the envelope that I just found. Then out of that eight, five move down here, but I can move seven Nichols and Wilcox down to here. Assuming I'm not gonna need 11, nine, eight buses down here, that's how we sort of do it. We go bus by bus, literally, who's on the bus? And then we're told there are 30 kids in the bus, then we gotta actually count how many kids are actually riding the bus. Because if you say you're on the bus and the majority of you, you're not, we're wasting money. So we're going to go line by line, bus by bus, to figure that out.
All right, next question. I'll read them as I feel.
Oh, yes, ma'am.
Dr. Robinson wants me to use a microphone. My wife tells me my voice is very loud, so I assume I didn't need to do that. But go ahead, Mr. Chairman.
I feel as if the chart showing the schools and children within that school district is not complete. It doesn't show the children that currently attend the schools.
I would disagree with that. That's the last line. So you mean all the kids that attend the school, whether they are based there or not?
Yeah, that's the first one. That was the first question. I feel as though if the charts showing the schools and the children within the school district is not complete, it doesn't show the children that currently attend the school.
It does not show the children that currently attend the school, because what we're trying to figure out is if someone was based or who should be attending the school, so who's there currently is not the relevant question. The relevant question is, if everyone was in their quote-unquote neighborhood schools, what would the school look like? So we have the data on who's currently attending the school. I can easily show that. That's a different chart. It's different information.
Okay. How many classrooms are in each school, and what is each capacity of each classroom?
The number of classrooms per school varies in the size of the buildings. For instance, Lordship has two classrooms per grade, so that's 14 classrooms. Chapel and Second Hill Lanes have had major additions, so they have a multitude of classrooms. Wilcoxon has physically smaller classrooms, so we put fewer kids in those classrooms. The space is physically smaller, so we try to average 20 kids per classroom at the kindergarten level at every school except for Wilcoxon.
That's not true.
I'll repeat my statement. We try to average 20 kids per classroom at kindergarten level, except at Wilcoxon. Wilcoxon has a physically smaller classroom space, so we try to average 18 kids per classroom at Wilcoxon. As they go up in grades, we increase that number.
How will the new lines be drawn?
There has not been any determination that new lines will be drawn, so I can't answer that because it may not be necessary to draw new lines. That's part of the details we have to figure out.
Is there any concern that the state has yet to pass a budget, and how will this impact Stratford?
There is always concern because the state, they decide to reduce their funding at the local level. There's a trickle-down effect to the municipalities, which may or may not affect the schools. There's too many variables for us to determine that.
Okay. Are all waivers going to be rescinded?
Has to be determined.
Okay. In the event of a school overflow of kids, how do you determine which kids that will go to that school or what school the other kids will go to?
We do it on a case-by-case basis based on availability of nearest bus stop, class size configuration. So it's sort of a holistic approach to try to figure out where the kids should be. It's basically what we've been doing currently. But that was the bottom line.
Okay. All right, where is the redistricting plan?
We don't have a redistricting plan to show because we haven't voted on whether there's going to be a redistricting plan. I said we don't have one to show. I did not say we did not have one.
How are you balancing school percentages to reflect our town as a whole? Let me just give a number here. 85% versus 40% is a significant difference.
I think it says we all deserve the same diversity. I cannot provide you the exact same diversity. It's mathematically impossible. We have a minority population of 59%, so in order to mathematically make it work, given schools are different sizes, there's no way you're going to get the exact same diversity in every building. We've worked to get everyone closer to our district average of 59. In the last 5 years, we've achieved that. If the board decides to do this, we're going to try to maintain that. It may change slightly, but that will still be our goal. Our goal won't change, just some of the numbers may change, but we will always be within the legal limits.
How are you equitably splitting busing of students? Neither race should bear the busing of the students. Legally, this must be done.
Right now, race doesn't factor into who gets bused. But in reality, based on the current plan, which is from the 90s, it's just disproportionately going towards two or three minority groups who live in certain neighborhoods. That's one of the things we're trying to correct. I think we believe that if we did this, the whole racial composition of students who are actually bused will change dramatically.
Okay, in what ways does this new plan affect teaching and learning?
It shouldn't have any effect on teaching and learning because our students haven't changed just with the building they occupy would change. So teaching and learning should be perceived as normal.
Question. Why were 60 teachers not renewed if we are saving money? We'll discuss that after
Do you want me to?
We have to, we finish.
Would you like me to respond, or?
No.
Okay.
How will this make the district more marketable to people moving here?
I can't speak to marketability for real estate brokers. We're charged with educating children, so that's what we focus on. Whether that changes the marketability of a certain property, I can't speak to.
What is your long-term cost savings goal with this?
My long-term cost savings goal is to take that $4 million number for transportation and drop it dramatically. Then hopefully we can reinvest those funds into actually educating children instead of transporting them.
This one here, you may have to, if district lines are redrawn, will ALPS and other special ed programs continue? ALPS is not a special ed program.
Actually, it is. By definition, it's a special ed program. It's not a required special ed program. It is a special ed program. That's why it's one of the pupil services, Mrs. Marino's direction, but it's not a mandated special ed program.
Thank you.
To answer the question, each program we looked at on an individual basis. Mandated programs will obviously continue. Non-mandated programs, there will be a discussion with the senior leadership of the district and the Board of Ed about what they want to do in regards to non-mandated programs.
Can you make this data and information presented publicly available to the people of Stratford?
Yeah, what we've shown tonight, we can add to the website. It will may require some explanation, but it can easily, and we're videotaping right now, so the people of Stratford can watch the videotape, so, or non-residents could also watch if they so choose.
How are feeder schools to middle and high schools going to change?
The only place that may need to change, as I said last week, is that there will need to be a bifurcation of the Stratford Academy District because there's too many kids in Stratford Academy District that would, by current designation, would go to Stratford High. So at some point, we'd have to sort of subdivide Stratford Academy's district and say, some are going to Flood and Worcester, some are going to Bunnell and Stratford. Everyone else should stay the same, but we have to stress test that. We have to look at the numbers and see what it looks like as kids progress to the middle school level.
So for parents that have multiple students at one particular school, will they be guaranteed that they will attend all the same school coming in the fall? If you have multiple students at one particular school, will they be guaranteed to all attend the same school this coming fall?
I would say yes, with a caveat. Until decisions are made about certain programs, I can't unequivocally say yes, because you can see, as I told the board last week, let's take ALPS for example. You could keep it where it is, you could move it, you could phase it out at the same place or new place, or you can disband it. There are children now who are siblings at Stratford Academy because their older siblings are in ALPS. So that may have to change. That's something that the final details that the central administration will have to work out with the boards, you know, as a partner of the board, because right now, some people are in Stratford County just because they have an older sibling in ALPS.
Okay. This is not a question, this is more of a, it says, please post both the interactive color coded maps and the PDF with counts by school buses.
Yes, that's what we're talking about. The only thing we cannot do, we may have to find a way for Mr. Bryce's maps to subdivide them, because there's a tab on there, which is private student data, which we can't post. So we've got to figure out a way to how to print the other sheets without disclosing that information. We post it as is, that information would be viewed by the public, which would be a federal violation, which we're not going to do that. So we may have to try to find a way we can print it out and then post out the printout. But right now, the first tab in that worksheet is private student data. That's how we create the map based on the private student data.
When was the last time Stratford did a realignment like this?
I've been here 5 years, so I can't answer that question. I don't know when the last time they did one. Well, when was that?
The last time we did a realignment was approximately 2005-06, when we moved the boundary lines. Wilcoxon at the time was going to flood Bunnell, and at the time, the superintendent at that time spoke with the board, and they changed, the board voted to change the lines for Wilcoxon kids to go to Worcester Stratford High. That was in...
So 13 years ago, about.
Yes. Okay. That was not a happy time in Stratford either. Okay, what happens to the neighborhood kids who do not fit into the neighborhood schools?
The only place we have that problem where neighborhood kids wouldn't fit would be in Nichols and Stratford Academy. There are more kids than seats available, so those kids, for instance, there's a good number of neighborhood kids that aren't already at Nichols, they may just stay where they are because we don't have enough seats. Stratford Academy kids, we have a good number, 181 of them are already at Lordship because there's not enough seats, so they may just stay at Lordship. So the problem may have a ready solution. If not, we may have to, for instance, let's say it's a Nichols kid that's at one school, not of seats, we got to determine, do they stay at the current school or another school? There's only Nichols and Stratford Academy are the only ones that have that problem. You don't take those questions.
Just write it down. We have to be fair, people did ask, write their questions down, so I'm trying to go through the cards first. So let me get through the cards. I know some of you have two or three questions on. I'm trying to go through them. If we get more time, we'll go through them again until 8 o'clock. Did you use current data or incoming data?
That question is not clear. What I've shown is current data. We have incoming data. We have already broken down the currently registered kindergarten. So in reality, if we do this, we will lock off the sixth grade because they're moving off the middle school, and we'll add the registered kindergarten so they get our profile for next fall.
Is there already a plan established that you are not sharing?
Yes.
How do you plan to handle special education students who may be redistricted?
The federal law trumps everything, so whatever their 504 says, if we can only accommodate in a particular building, that's where they stay. If it can be done in any building, then we'll move them. And that's going to, the special ed case is going to be the most delicate process here. If a special ed child is not in their home building, gyms, as a program there, some programs may move. So that means a lot of special ed kids may move with that program. That means staff may move with the program also. Keep continuity with the kids. If a program gets moved, the staff that's working with those kids will also move.
When will the new district lines be announced?
As I said earlier, there's been no decision whether the lines could be changed.
Okay. What is the plan to continue the strings program at other schools?
That's one of the programs that I spoke of that we have to determine whether it gets moved, stays in place, disbanded, or phased out.
If you live within the 1.5 miles in an elementary school, how is it decided which school your child will attend if they are already in a school?
If you live within 1.5 miles of the school, that school that you live within 1.5 miles, generally speaking, is your base school. Unless you live within 1.5 miles of multiple schools, then you have to look at the street directory to determine what is your base school. Once we determine what your base school is, if you live within 1.5 miles of your base school, that's where you'll be placed. If you do not live within 1.5 miles of your base school, you still may be placed there, but you'll just be provided the bus.
Which school you're going, your
children. You have to go on our website, look up our street directory, find your street, and some streets have multiple schools based on the street, find your Your address range for your street, and it'll tell you what your elementary school is, what your middle school, which high school.
I'm currently in school, is what I'm saying.
You're currently what?
I'm currently already, my children are already currently in school, but if they were to redistrict, how is it determined if you are?
There's no determination of redistrict. If your child's already in their neighborhood school, none of this would affect your children. They would just stay where they are. Which one, you don't have two neighborhood schools, because you may live within one of the two schools, but you have a school that's designated by your street address, which your neighborhood school, that is your neighborhood school.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
What will the Title I school funding look like when the district is redistricted?
First of all, like I said, we haven't determined redistricting, but if the children move, the Title I funds move with the children. So Title I is based where the children are educated, so if a bunch of children, let's say a chapel that creates chapel be a Title I school and they move to a different school, those funds follow the students.
Most DOEs take months, even years, to research, investigate, including focus groups. What has been done in this respect for our students and community?
All I can say is we have a situation where time is of essence. We would love to take the time, but July 1 is fast approaching. We don't have that luxury. If someone would like to take the luxury, they would have to find another way to come with $2.2 million in less than 60 days.
Has the DOE looked at the concentration of poverty in this redistricting plan?
There is no redistricting plan, but yes, we have looked at the concentration of poverty.
The question is, the decision of redistricting should be made in the best interest of our students. How is this plan in your best interest?
Well, some of you have heard me talk about the scenarios of children that live in the South End and go to school at St. Chapel. We've heard from some parents and faculty that we have a tardyism problem, we have an absenteeism problem. If kids happen to miss their bus, they may not make it to school. That's affecting their education. But if they live in a neighborhood, missing the bus is not a problem. So we believe, and we have some other districts have done this, and I can answer the question, or we just go. So it is our belief that children being able to attend their neighborhood schools will benefit them, and that we will reduce our absenteeism and our tardiness for certain students. Not all students, but for certain students.
Is the BOE open to allowing parents to continue to drive their 4th, 5th, and 6th graders to Johnson House during this transition?
We are open to it. The problem is not the transportation you just grabbed your child. Your child is occupying a seat we may need for a child that's somewhere else. If they don't give up that seat, I can't bring those other children back. So it's the busing part and also the simple question of real estate. They're in the seat. We need the seat. We have 800 plus children, or 795 children, who by where they live should be able to attend Stratford County, but can't. So if children stay in those seats, where do they go? That means the children that could take those seats are still somewhere else. It means we're still busing them. So the problem hasn't been solved.
Can the BOE guarantee that my child will be allocated to her neighborhood school if moved from Johnson House? Is there a possibility she would be bused somewhere else?
That would depend on what your neighborhood school is. Because at every school except in Nichols, and maybe potentially Franklin, we have plenty of space, we don't have any racial balancing issues. But we have to make sure that we provide an education to every child. So our goal is to get as many kids back in the Bay school as possible. We're not gonna get every kid back, we know that. That's why we're not saying busing is gonna be eliminated. We're just trying to reduce it as much as possible.
How can you guarantee my child will go to their home school, especially if it is full?
As I just said, we're not guaranteeing anything. The school may be full now, but we got to see what it looks like when we take out the kids who aren't based there. So that's the question. The only places where we put everyone in the building that would be overpassed is Nichols and Stratford County.
I think this one is, what happens if there's no plan in 60 days?
You got
to come right to the chase.
That one, if we don't get a plan, I've got to make immediate decisions with Dr. Robinson about how to cut $2.2 million, and that means probably staff reductions.
Here's a question. I don't know if you need to answer this one, but since why didn't you ask the town council to fully fund the original budget request?
Yes, I can't answer that. I said I can't answer that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the board got together, and many of you already know, and I'll say it again. The Board of Education got together with the members that were there, as well as the new members. We sat and listened to the presentation of our superintendent. At that time, we looked at the total culture of what was going on in Stratford, where we are with our taxes and our tax base, and the enormity of how much money we've asked for in the past. And we came in what we felt was a budget that we felt that the town council as well as the mayor's office would fund, so that we weren't going back and forth fighting, name calling, and making, we weren't going to put on a show. That's not what I asked my board to do. I asked them to sit and think and to legitimately come up with a budget that we felt that the council and the mayor would fund for us. We weren't going to put on a show and go back and forth and have parents go over and stand before the council and say things to them or say things to the mayor. That is what we did. I know that the board members, we took an enormous amount of time and we submitted a budget that we felt would be doable for all of Stratford. That includes our taxpayers, that includes our stakeholders, that includes our children and our business owners. We took into account what we felt we could live with and what we could do, and we can still move our district forward.
Mr. Chairman, can I add to that? The reality of the situation is, given the budget turmoil we had last year, in my opinion, the board decided they were going to try to avoid that, because if they didn't, they would run the risk of the council coming in for an even lower number. You have a new council, don't know what they're going to do. So it's either you do it yourself or you take the risk. So I give them credit. They took on the burden of trying to figure out what's the best way to move us forward, take care of the children of Stratford, and not run the risk of even further cuts. Because if you, as I said the other night, if you do any searches of school budgets in the state, this is happening almost every town in Connecticut. It's not going away, ladies and gentlemen. It's a new paradigm. We've got to get used to it. So I personally applaud the board's courage to deal with it head on. And they did. And obviously it must have worked, because the council didn't change the number they came up with. So they took the burden, they bore the risk, they took it upon themselves, they got it done. Now they are allowing us this process to go forward to figure out how we're going to achieve those things. So that's what we're here tonight to talk about, the various options.
How have you placed incoming kindergartners if no plan was voted for? And I know some have been for a fact.
Right? Well, that would be incorrect, because I haven't placed any kindergartners. The only people that know have access to that list is me, and I haven't placed anybody, so I have to beg to differ that you know that for a fact, because I haven't put anybody anywhere.
Question is, do you know when a decision will be made by?
I can't speak for the board.
Soon.
So can someone else answer that question?
Yes, I am. As a chair, very soon. I would say within a week, because we have to have.
The question was, when will the decision be made?
Is that when we get to know what the plan is?
A plan?
I said, is that what?
Yes, you have a plan.
We'll decide to vote, so we have no say or know anything. You're just going to vote on it and show it to us. Yes, correct.
I'll speak with you after.
Yeah, we don't love to hear the answer to that.
Yeah, we don't.
Yeah, the answer is we will have a vote in a week to let you know what will happen. And we're voting on trying to save $2.2 million.
The question was, are we...
We're going to save, we're going to vote on $2.2 million. That's what we're going to vote on. $2.2 million is what we need to save. I know what your question is. I hear your question.
Answer.
$2.2 million is what we have to... And one week...
This is children, not money.
I know, ma'am. I understand. Can I, just want to finish the last, these three cards here. This one will there be enough helpers, tutors to accommodate all the tier 2 and 3 students once relocated?
Tutors would move with students. So if students are relocated and there's where they need of a different building, tutors would move to where the need is. We don't just keep them in place because we have different types of tutors, first of all, so it all depends on what type of tutors we're talking about. We have different types of tutors, so it depends on what type of tutors you're referring to. So if a child, let's say it's a Title I funded tutor, if the kids move and the Title I funds move, those Title I tutors will move with the children. But we have other types of tutors that may stay in place based on whatever their job description is.
This is a personal one. My daughter is waived to Second Hill, has been since kindergarten. She is going into sixth grade. Will she age out or be moved for her last year?
I can't speak on an individual child, but if a parent, whatever decisions are made, all parents are able to apply for a boundary line waiver. It may or may not be granted, but if you feel like, in this case, your daughter's been in school for 5 years or 6 years and you want them to stay, please, I encourage you to apply for the boundary line waiver and we'll try to accommodate. And place like Second Hill, where we have a lot of space, I can't see any reason why that wouldn't be granted, but you wouldn't get transportation. But we have space at Second Hill, so it's not a problem. Places where we don't have space, it could be a problem. It's just a supply demand issue in regards to seats.
What school will Stratford Academy students go to that don't fit at the academy? 180 will remain at Lordship. Second Hill Lane has seats. Are there any other schools?
Well, first we keep the 181 at Lordship. The question becomes, how many can we fit into Stratford Academy? First we try to fit them in whatever residual left over. Depending on their composition, then we'll determine where they go. No,
if
we'll have
some discussion, is he like with me? Where should we call me?
I've been instructed to tell you to ask your question on a card, ma'am.
I did, that was my card. You didn't answer.
Okay, so the question is, if that's your card, any school is an option, because it's a question of seats. So once we have the majority of kids placed and we need extra seats, we look for any available seat that's the shortest ride for a child to get on a bus. So the next closest school that has seats, we'll look at that school. Does that work? If it doesn't work, we'll go to the next closest. The point is to try to avoid kids being on a bus right now for 45 minutes in some cases.
Do the schools currently have lists of neighborhood children and non-neighborhood children that they are using for planning for next year?
The schools do not know.
Where can I see actual year-to-date numbers for the current and prior year?
I don't know what year-to-date numbers you're talking about, so.
Hold on 1 second. Year-to-date numbers, who?
Budget.
Raise your hand.
Budget.
Okay. Where can I see the actual year-to-date numbers for the current year and prior year budget numbers?
Is that germane to the next topic?
On the website for now. Let's see. Can we answer this question? So what is the plan you are not sharing with us?
The plan that I'm not sharing is the plan we're formulating to try to solve this problem.
Give me 1 second, please. Just want to make sure I get this right. Okay, so if you have several children going to the same school, will the siblings be bused to the same schools in the upcoming, in this coming fall? If you have several kids in the school, the academy.
That's what's being.
Will you guarantee that siblings will be bused together to the same schools?
Okay, so you have multiple children at Stratford Academy.
Three.
So the question becomes, are they just at Stratford Academy or are they in special programs?
No special programs.
Excuse me?
No special programs.
Then we make a point to make sure we try to keep siblings together. So
we will guarantee that all three will go to, for instance, Second Hill Lane.
So yeah, I'm not going to split up siblings. Unless, now, certain situations the parent may choose. Let's say one of your child was in Alps and they decide, the board decides to keep Alps at Stratford Academy. The other children wouldn't stay, so you'd have a choice, either take the kid out of Alps or keep with their siblings.
Say excluding special
ed. Yes, excluding that, siblings are going to stay together.
Siblings will absolutely stay together.
Yes.
Do you realize these are humans' lives?
Yes.
Like you, like yours and your children's. That you are abruptly shuffled. If this was your child's district, would you like this?
So let me give you an example of my child's district. District I used to live in, my child had a 1 hour bus ride for racial balancing issues. He drove by two middle schools to get to his middle school. He had to catch the bus at 6:30 in the morning as a sixth grader because our district had a racial balancing plan. I didn't like the fact that he had to take the bus at 6:30 because I lived in New York an hour. But that's what he had to do. So I understood what I did, I didn't argue it, I just didn't like it, so I took him out. So I did what I had to do, I thought was my child's best interest, but I didn't grudge the district because they had a racial balancing problem and they took kids from my neighborhood in Boston to the farthest middle school away. So he had a 1 hour bus ride as a sixth grader. It is what it is, and that's a local Fairfield County town. So I've lived it, I understand. The districts do what they have to do.
My daughter attends before and after school at Sterling House, where there be transportation provided to Sterling House from my neighborhood school at the end of the day.
We have partnered with Sterling House to provide transportation now. We don't have to, but we've done that because we think it's the right thing to do. So wherever Sterling House has children that attend, we try to see if there's a bus that travels by Sterling House, so we basically add a bus stop. So it depends on if there is a bus leaving their daughter's day school that travels by Sterling House. We don't add extra routes, but if we have a bus going by, we put a child on the bus and we create a new stop at Sterling House, let the kids off.
Are you aware of nationwide studies about the beneficial outcomes of socioeconomic balancing in school districts?
Yes.
Many districts are adding busing to address this.
Those that can afford it.
Although Stratford may be racially balanced, it is not economically balanced.
It may not be, but we have a dilemma. There's things we'd like to do, and there's things we can afford to do. We've got to figure out what our choices are. I have no problems if you all are willing to raise your tax and pay for this, great. But I don't hear that. So we got to pay for this somehow. And it's a choice the citizens of Stratford have to decide. If they're willing to do this, then they should speak to the elected officials and town council and ask for more money.
We did, they didn't ask for it.
We currently have 5 minutes left. Why are you saying that you'd rather fund programs than take buses? That implies you will have extra money for programs when you will not.
I don't imply that. I'm saying if we're able to reduce the cost of busing beyond what we need, that extra savings can be reallocated to programs. I'm not saying it's going to happen, but that would be the goal. If it does happen, then we have money to put in to spread programs throughout the district. It's a hopeful situation. The devil will be in the details of if we can achieve that or not.
You can add to this one. How do you plan on regaining our trust as a community to the BOE? I have served 15 years here on the Board of Ed, volunteered since 2001. I have volunteered in this community. So I stand on my own. I know the decisions that we have to make are the most difficult ones. And I'm not standing on my soapbox, but when I became chair in December, January, we were potentially going to have to lay off staff. And at that time, the community of Stratford filled my inbox with, please do not lay off any staff or teachers. They wanted to start a petition to fire the superintendent. 6 months in, we get through that, and now we're here trying to deal with this situation. So I stand on trust. I stand on what I do. I was elected by the people here, and I appreciate that. I really, really do. I don't hold myself higher than anybody. And I know my board members do not either. We feel your upsetness. We feel your
anxiety.
We feel your mistrust, or we feel the feelings that you feel. This is not easy coming in here to do this, but I am sitting here before you and I am doing this. We are doing this. And we will get through this. We got through January. We're going to get through this one. Ladies and gentlemen, this is very, very difficult. It is very emotional. This is not an easy task for any of us. I respect the fact that all of you have children, especially elementary. I have children who were elementary. My kids were used for racial balancing. So I understand the angst that you feel. Do not clap, please. That's not what we're here for. We're just here to try to work this problem out the best way that we can. I think we have time for two more questions. And I'm just giving you a minute because I want to go through one of the cards here.
Clarence, I have a question.
You gotta write it down, sir. You're like everybody else.
Yes, we do.
Would you like the card?
Let me ask a question. What you can get, write it down then. Mr. Zachary?
Yes, sir.
Forgive me as I ask this question. What do the boundary line waiver students do to the counts by school buses? I believe that is it.
By board policy, boundary line waiver students are not given provided transportation. After October 1, if there's space available on a bus, on a case-by-case basis, they may be allowed on a bus. That seat on the bus is contingent upon no student arriving who need that bus, and they can be bumped off. So boundary line waivers should not affect the busing.
Okay. Give me 1 second, please. We're coming down to the finals. What will the pathway be for Franklin and Wilcoxon? Will it stay the same?
I haven't heard any discussion of pathway changes.
Thank you. We will not answer any questions about non-renewals. Because we're not here to vote on that. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, whenever I will submit these cards to Dr. Robinson, any of the ones that were posed that we will not be able to get to this evening, I will ask her to have those answered. We will be here again tomorrow. For some parents weren't able to make it this evening, we will be here tomorrow starting at 7:30. We will go till 9. Again, Mr. Zachary will give his presentation. Again, we will give parents the opportunity who are not here to ask their questions. We will then sit as a board and try to again figure more of this information out and figure out what our course of action will be. And it is now 8:01, and I am closing our special meeting.